Cult is the name, or cult is the title given to those religious and non-religious groups which pretend to be the original group. For example, Christianity, the Christian faith. There are many groups that claim to be Christians, but they are not Christians. Bible-believing Christians have always spotted such people and opposed them. Always opposed them. And since we have to oppose them, Bible-believing Christians have always given much attention to cult studies. But in the last 20 years, cult studies has been in decline. To spot something that is wrong and to say that it is wrong has somehow become an unacceptable activity. Why has it become unacceptable? I mean, we, particularly we, the brethren, we take so much pride. I'm using the word pride in a good sense. We take so much pride in holding on to fundamental truths, holding on to that which is true. And yet, when it comes to people who spread false ideas, why did we oppose them for almost 90 years after the Brethren movement started? And why 90 or even 100 years after the Brethren movement started, but why we have stopped opposing them in the last 20 years? And why are we closing our eyes to the fact that people in false cults are stealing our young people? So much so that now many false cults are active inside the assemblies, and we just close our eyes. We close our eyes to the fact that they are working inside the assemblies. I remember my experience last week. Before I had the surgery, they gave me so many instructions. And to take me to surgery, they put me on a wheelchair and they covered my front with a bed sheet. They took me to, via the lift, they took me to another room. They removed this bed sheet and put a second one. Then from there, they took me to a third room. And after waiting there for some time, they took me to the surgical theater. But before doing all this, before they took me out of the room, they asked me to remove all my clothing and wear a sterile disposable garment. And they said not even a thread should be there on your body, the original clothing. So starting from there, multiple levels of isolation from possible contamination and bacteria and viruses. And once I was taken to the surgical theater, my hand, the surgery was to take place here, but they put betadine not here, up to this place or even more, front of the hand, back of the hand. They covered it and kept it that way for quite some time. Why all this care? See, after all, a surgery, take me from my room, cut and solve the problem and suture it and send me back. Because when something that is dangerous can invade our body, then it has to be kept away, lest it invade and destroy our body in one way or another. And we don't see any carelessness in these practices in surgical theaters. This was my 6th and 7th surgery in the last 7 years. And each year I am noticing that they are becoming more and more and more strict in the procedures that they follow. Why? Harmful organisms have to be kept out of the body. Then, why have we become so careless about the body of Christ? There are a lot of harmful organisms. There are a lot of harmful believers, harmful groups, which are hurting the church. We have come to a stage where we have forgotten that we need to keep harmful things outside the church, and now they are inside the church. Let me give you an example. Because if I start with an example, it will sort of arouse your curiosity. Many, many of you, or probably all of you, have heard this claim that Hindu Vedas contain many statements about Lord Jesus Christ. Have you heard that? I heard it when I was studying in 8th standard, and that was back in 1967-68. GLS even published a tract at that time, and it was published in all Indian languages and circulated, claiming that 9 prophecies about Lord Jesus Christ are found in Vedas. Have you heard that? Have you heard that a certain Hindu god by the name of Prajapati is Lord Jesus Christ? That is a super cult. I'll explain the difference between cult and super cult very soon. And I want to remind you that is a super cult which has its origin in what is known as Lucifer Foundation. In 1922, a foundation was started in USA by a lady whose name is Alice Bailey. Alice Bailey claimed that God, the Jehovah, is our enemy and Lucifer is our friend. God wants to hurt us. Lucifer wants to help us, and therefore we should worship Lucifer. With the help of a demon by the name of Dhvaj Kul, dictated approximately 65 books. And Lucifer Foundation has been publishing these 65 books ever since 1922. It is going to be a century. For last one century, Lucifer Foundation has been spreading this message. And out of Lucifer Foundation, many, many movements have come, and two of them have infected the brethren. One is the Prajapati Christ super cult. And I am also sure that many of you have heard about what is known as pranic healing. Some of you may have not heard the word pranic healing, but you may have heard the word Reiki. They are the same. They are actually twins. Two forms of the same thing. Many, many evangelists in Kerala, they were using pranic healing as part of their evangelistic activity. Some were boasting that using pranic healing, we are attracting people to Christ. That's so surprising. Because again, pranic healing is a practice which has come from Lucifer Foundation. So in the last 20 to 30 years, we, the New Testament pattern believers who claim to believe the Word of God and who claim to teach the Word of God as it is, we have allowed Lucifer Foundation And the spokesmen, spokespeople of Lucifer Foundation to infiltrate the Brethren assemblies, so much so that today they are everywhere and they are proclaiming teachings of Lucifer Foundation as part of Brethren movement, and they have been bringing practices of Lucifer Foundation where you heal people with the help of demons and demonic power. They have been bringing it to the Brethren assemblies. Why has this happened? It happens when we do not study the fundamentals carefully. If you get a cut, and if you go to an allopathic doctor's clinic, and if the doctor takes a bottle, just puts his finger into the bottle and takes an ointment and applies it to your wound, I'm sure you would be horrified. And probably next day you would come up with an infection in the wound. An allopathic doctor works for 5.5 years as a student. And I tell you, it is a maddening study. After that, he or she undergoes internship, which is more maddening. And in 21st century, many of them go for a post-graduation, which is much more maddening. They have their training. And since they have their training, they follow protocols properly. Go to a naturopathy doctor. I know it because I'm trained in naturopathy. I'm a distinction student and graduate in naturopathy. You go to a naturopathy doctor, he will just put his fingers into the bottle. He will take the ointment and apply it on the wound. Do you know why? There is very little training. There are practically no protocols. They are not taught about germs. In fact, they are taught to deny the existence of microbes, germs, viruses. Same way, just as an allopathic doctor is trained years after years in theory and also in practice and also through apprenticeship, internship, in the same way, we brethren had the habit. Right from the first generation, we had the habit. The senior ones would study the Word of God very, very thoroughly. They would devote hours together to study it. And after that, they would teach it systematically. Doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be mature, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So they studied it thoroughly. And our local churches were Bible schools where such instruction was given in detail and elaborately and in depth. That habit has died out. Today, now I am a traveling evangelist and therefore I visit a large number of assemblies. And if you ask me, I would say that of 100 assemblies that I know, probably one has a systematic training program. 99 out of 100 brethren assemblies, any Dick, Tom, Harry who visits a church is given the pulpit. Just any Dick, Tom, Harry, whether he has any standing in the community, whether his testimony is all right or not, and whether he has studied the scripture or not. And many, many of these traveling people, I have known many of them closely. I have heard their messages here and there. They manage their whole life with half a dozen messages. Instead of doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness, they manage with exhortation. Instead of giving solid food, they manage with soft drinks. And I have seen, very rarely only have I seen a church where there is a systematic program for studying and teaching the Word of God. It takes a lot of effort to study and teach the Word of God. And that is the reason why now elders are shrinking from their job. You may say, Brother Johnson, are you speaking against elders? Brothers and sisters, I myself am. I continue to be the elder of a church. I'm a member of Kalamasheri Church. But please remember, Dr. Sanish Churiyan and I, we started a church at Mulandurithi, at Manid. And as long as the Lord does not raise up capable brothers to take over, till that time, I will have a supervisory role there also. So I'm speaking as a fellow elder. I was an elder in many more churches before this. And I want to tell you, my fellow elders who are attending this meeting, my fellow evangelists who are attending this meeting, and my fellow Bible teachers who are attending this meeting, we have become very careless about our call. Instead of behaving like a carefully trained allopathic physician or surgeon, we have started behaving like naturopaths who even deny the existence of viruses and bacteria. That is the reason why false cults are invading the Christian community, stealing our young people. I have been here in Kerala for last 26 years, and almost every year I see at least half a dozen young people leaving the brethren assemblies and ending up in one cult or another. Bible believing Christians have always been aware of cults. We have always studied them. We have always fought against them. And please remember, in the last few decades, they have become very, very dangerous. Till a few years ago, when a Jehovah Witness would come to your home, he or she would clearly identify, we are from Jehovah's Witnesses churches. Today, when they come, they would say, we are also believers like you. We have a local church here. If they go to a brethren family, they will say, we have a local church here. We believe exactly like you believe. How do I know? Oh, this is a big, I live in an area which is a big evangelistic focus for Jehovah Witnesses. And almost every 3 months, we get somebody from Jehovah Witnesses trying to convert us. They, originally, they used to identify. Today, they no longer identify themselves. There is a very, very dangerous cult which has its base in Kerala. They are so dangerous that if you tell them that they are a cult, they will drag you to court. They have billions in funding. They will simply drag you to court. Fortunately, in India, they have not done. They have dragged a lot of Christians in USA. In India, it's not so easy to drag a person over differences of faith. Our legal system is rather supportive of diversity. So what are they using now? They are using the latest psychological information to attack us. For example, many of these cults have very systematically studied why resistance, why people resist a cult. And after doing research into why people resist a cult, they have developed methods to overcome the resistance. All of you are interested in witnessing, and I'm sure that all of you do witness from time to time. Many of you are preachers. You go out for preaching. Tell me, my dear brothers and my dear sisters who go out for witnessing, do the brethren have any kind of systematic training on how to witness and how to overcome resistance? Let me tell you, for decades, the Jehovah Witnesses have a handbook. How to share your faith, what are the possible objections, and how to answer each objection. For decades, the Jehovah Witnesses had a handbook like that. I have seen that handbook. One or two brethren people have seen that handbook. It's a very, very secret document. And showing it to outsiders is a crime. But at least two of us have seen that. In the same way, this area is a big focus of Muslim evangelization. I live in an area which is a big focus of Muslim outreach. And they come to our area approximately once in 6 months. And in a very systematic manner, they brainwash Christians. They also have handbooks. Once, I still remember, some 25 years ago, when Dr. Sanish Churian was in second year, BTH, Brethren Bible Institute, one man came to convert me. One Muslim came to convert me. And he was so surprised. None of his arguments worked on me. I was able to answer all his arguments, or I was able to refute all his arguments. And he said, that is so shocking. Nobody has been able to do it. And he became so, what should I say, stunned. He said, sir, look at this file. This is our handbook using which we study how to attack people like you. And he had become so influenced. I said, please give it to us so that we may inspect. And many, many of us inspected that handbook. Do we have something like that? When somebody comes and attacks our faith, if such and such question is asked, how to answer? No, we don't have. But the cults, false cults, they know that if you have to win people, then first of all, you have to present your faith in the most acceptable manner. They are given systematic training in how to present in the most acceptable manner. Then they also know that even if you present in the most acceptable manner, the moment people realize that your teachings are different from the teachings of Christian faith, they will resist. So they are given training in how to overcome resist, how to answer each objection against you. Even the strongest objection that you and I, we can bring to a Jehovah Witness or a Seventh-day Adventist or a Muslim, the strongest objections, how to refute them is taught to them systematically. What do we do? Till the start of COVID, we 8 or 9 brothers used to go out for house-to-house witnessing multiple times every week. 2 by 2 we used to go. And when we would go, most of the people would be receptive to our literature, but a few would oppose and ask questions. And the moment they bring objections against the Christian faith, I was always shocked. Many of my, not all, but many of my companions would give such stupid answer or such provocative answer without realizing that if you give a stupid answer, you will be rejected. If you give a provocative answer, you will be rejected. and they will become provoked and they will kick you out. We do not teach any of these things, and as a result, the cults are gradually infiltrating our houses, our homes, our families, stealing away our young people, and now they have become so bold that they have their people inside our assemblies, inside brethren assemblies, and standing here, they advocate cult doctrines. Because if a few people are influenced by cult doctrines, eventually these people can be moved to that cult. We also need to remember that in the past, the battle of the cults, it's a real battle. The brethren have lost hundreds of young people in the last 20 to 25 years. Last 20 to 25 years has been a time of accelerated loss. I personally know of hundreds of people whom we have lost. So if an individual knows hundreds, just imagine how many might have been lost, whom I don't know, how many we lost in Mumbai, how many we lost in Bangalore, how many we lost in Chennai, how many in Delhi, how many in Calcutta, how many in other larger cities, we just don't know. The battle has become accelerated. And also, in the past, it was only a battle of doctrine. Today, it has become a highly sophisticated psychological battle. You may ask, psychological? Yes. For example, today, they have stationed very, very attractive and seductive young girls in centers of education. These young girls, these young and attractive and sexy girls, they talk only to boys. They have also stationed very young, attractive and handsome young men. And these handsome young men always talk only to girls. And this way, they use their sexual charm and seduction to trap our young people. You may say, brother, I live in a remote area and such people don't come here. There are two mistakes in that. Number one, young people may not come to the small town. These enemies may not come to the small town in which you are living, but your boy, your girl, our children, they will not always remain in the small town in which you are. For education, they will leave your small town. Both of my children, because they wanted to study special courses. My son wanted to go to medicine. He got a scholarship to study at Vellore. And he spent all his college life at Christian Medical College, Vellore. Vellore is a place where cults are focusing. My daughter wanted to go to microbiology. And for microbiology, we had to send her to Coimbatore. Again, a center, a focus of people in cults. So don't excuse yourself or don't try to excuse yourself by saying, brother, I live in a small town. And the people of these false cults will not come to this small town. Please think of your boy. Please think of your girl. Think of our beloved children in the brethren and non-brethren community. Community similar to the brethren. Think of them. Tomorrow they will be going out of your small village, small town. Then what? Then their condition is like that of an exposed wound, which is exposed to all kind of microorganisms, viruses, and infections. So we have to do our preparation even if you are staying in a small town. Second, even medium level towns are now their focus. Most of you know that I spent the first 40 years of my life in a city known as Gwalior. Gwalior is well known, but it is not a big city. It is not a cosmopolitan or metropolitan city yet. 40 years ago, yes, please listen to me. 40 years ago, a cult known as Children of God infected our town. And Children of God is one of the most dangerous cults. Most cults use only sexual appeal and sexual charm to seduce young people. Children of God is a cult which uses sex to trap people. All women in that cult are prostitutes. All women. The first day they join the cult, they are told that they have to give their bodies to Christ. Romans chapter 12 verse 1. Give your bodies as a living sacrifice. And they teach women in the cult, giving your body as a living sacrifice to Christ means allow Christ to use your body to win others to Christ. You may ask, how do you know? I interacted very closely with Children of God. Gwalior is not a cosmopolitan city. It's a medium town. I studied in one of the finest schools. I taught in one of the finest in the same school. I also taught in the university. So I have a large following. One of my students runs the biggest hotel in Gwalior. Hotel chain, I should say. The largest number of rooms. Once he saw some Christians, some people who claimed to be Christians, and he found that their activity was very suspicious. Immediately he called me and said, Johnson, sir, a group of people who claim to be Christians, they have come and stayed in my hotel. They are staying here and their activities look very, very suspicious. Would you please pick up your motorbike and rush to my office? So I rushed to the office in his hotel. I asked him, tell me, his name is Om Prakash, tell me what is wrong. And he said, sir, I believe that they claim to be Christians, but I believe that these women have a very immoral life. See, he's a Hindu. Even he suspected it. Eventually, he introduced me to the leader of the gang. I said hello to him. And he said, oh, yes, you're from Brethren Assemblies. We are also like that. You can't hide a fever from a doctor. I have been specializing in cults. I quickly, from their manner of speech, I deduced that they are a cult. And I told them, listen, you have come to a town where I have a very good mass root following. And I can kick you out, foreigners, I can kick you out within a moment from this town. All what I need is call one of the police officers who was a student of mine. Tell him that these people are harmful and he will see to it that you are deported. You will never be able to enter even India. Tell me who you are. And finally, they confessed that they are Children of God. They said, please don't harm us. We are Children of God. I said, you give me literature and you will not believe. They gave me literature which very clearly says that women in that organization are supposed to be public prostitutes to bring more and more people to Christ. So don't think that you are safe just because you are in a small town. Gwalior was a small town 40 years ago. But Gwalior was one of their centers. And without me knowing it, they had already visited the engineering college, identified some of the smartest boys there, and they were all members of my church. They visited medical college and they identified some of the smartest Christian girls. One of them was my sister, my own youngest sister. And they were trying to seduce these people. So don't think you're in a small town, you're safe. Just as in a surgery, nobody is safe from microorganisms. And just as a lot of precaution is taken, in the same way in our Christian life, nobody is immune from the influence of cults, the influence of false cults. They are standing at the door, knocking it, just waiting for you to open the door. Lord willing, we will go to a lot of details related to cults. Before we come to actual cults like Jehovah Witnesses, we will go to a lot of details because we live in a generation where all this detail is far more important than studying the cults themselves, because these details contain information about their strategies. And I will also be picking up a very elaborate passage from the scripture where people of God forgot their warrior mentality. And once they forgot their warrior mentality, they fell to the enemy. I thank God for the opportunity He gave me to present this class.